Michael was my intern in an emergency department, and I was his term supervisor. And as a part of his term supervision, we go through this term assessment report. One of the questions in term assessment report is what he wants to do, as in what he wants to specialize in. To my surprise, Michael, who looked very energetic and dynamic on the floor, he told me that he wants to do geriatric medicine. And at times when I hear most interns and medical students, they want to do ophthalmology and they want to do orthopedics or plastic surgery. And I just thought that I need to listen to his rationale and his reasoning behind geriatric medicine, because we find it very cumbersome, very frustrating. The patients are old, frail, they've got complex medical condition, they've got multiple comorbidities. Most patients have got some form of cognitive impairment or dementia, so the goals are not really well defined. As Dr. Michael puts a whole new perspective into geriatric medicine, which is very insightful, I think we should listen to him. So here's Dr. Michael telling me why he absolutely loves and is so passionate about geriatric medicine.
So we were having a conversation and you said that you like geriatrics. I just wanted to get your feeling as to what you really like about geriatric training, first of all.
Well, personally, I find it very satisfying. There is a big opportunity to take your time, work through a variety of medical and social problems. And I think you do have a little bit more time than some of the more interventional specialties to particularly sort out the discharges. And I find some of the most satisfying discharges I've had have been very complex geriatric patients with multi-system diseases and difficulty managing at home. And once you sort out the medical side of things, you can really make sure the benefits of an admission are sustained if you sort out the social aspects. And I've had a very satisfying discharges from complex patients.
Things that you still don't like about geriatrics, or frustrate you about geriatric treatment plans, and
one very frustrating thing is a lot of the subacute hospitals where geriatric patients end up spending the bulk of their admission are a little bit under-resourced in terms of urgent care. So the escalation for like someone who is unstable still kind of needs to be at a major hospital, which often doesn't have the same level of allied health involvement. So it can be an annoying balance of keeping them safe in a medical perspective, but slowing their discharge from an allied health perspective. I think often it does take a long time to work out. Some of their patients respond more slowly than you would otherwise think of a younger person as well. And quite often you're instituting a bunch of therapies, or someone comes in delirious. You're dealing with patients' family members' expectation of when they'll get better or what the cause of it was, and sometimes you just don't find out. I think a lot of people get treated for UTIs that may or may not exist because they're delirious and have something growing in their urine. So you can often feel a little bit unsatisfied with finding the true cause of a presentation, but I think it's outbalanced by the satisfying, if you can get a satisfying result, then it kind of balances out the not.
So Michael, I think the kind of patients that really frustrate me as an emergency physician are the patients who have not got clearly defined ceiling of care treatment. And you know, I have to cling to so many papers and, you know, make X number of phone calls to come and devise a new plan, albeit it's quite obvious that they're not going to benefit from any sort of invasive kind of treatment. What's your take on that?
Well, I think COVID particularly this year has changed that a bit, because a lot of family members are having that conversation that they otherwise wouldn't have had. I think at the end of the day, you respect the family's wishes to the point of being reasonable, and sometimes you can just, in an ED setting, it must be very frustrating because you've got to go, all right, we've got to find a diagnosis or something to start. I think once patients get onto the ward and you have a bit more time and people see how they're developing, that conversation becomes a lot easier with family members. But
do you think everybody above the age of 80 living in the community independently or in a facility should have some sort of advanced care planning?
I think as people become more frail, whether they are the age of 80 or a very unwell 65-year-old, that sort of thing should happen, that conversation should happen. But it's difficult to just blanket rule it, I think.
That's right.
But I think anyone that goes into a care facility should have this discussion, because a lot of patients don't want to come to hospital from their care facility.
I've actually come across some of the patients who have been sent from care facilities, and quite visibly they are in that extreme stage that you don't really want to do anything. And you'd be surprised the amount of time that I've called relatives and they said, what the hell are they doing in the hospital?
Yeah, so, that's very unfortunate.
Yeah, which is an unfortunate. So, at the end, I'd like to ask you top 5 tips for GMOs who want to consider a specialty but not too fussed about geriatrics. You need to convince them. Give me point number 1, 2, 3, and 4, and 5. Why should they choose geriatrics? Point 1.
It's very satisfying. You can improve more than one person's life very easily. If you get a good discharge, safe discharge home, you've got the patient and all of their very stressed family members.
Okay, so it's satisfying to achieve clearly defined goals in terms of maintaining independence from a semi-independent kind of person.
Or maybe it's even someone who is lonely at home who didn't realize that a care facility would be better from a social aspect point of view, and you've improved their mental health rather than their physical health. So that can be that is also very satisfying there.
Point taken.
Number two, very broad spectrum of practice.
Mm-hmm.
So there are more rehabilitation, slow stream geriatricians. You've got people who specialize in Parkinson's disease and Lewy body dementia and end stage neurological disorders. So you've got a very wide range.
The potential for growth.
Potential for growth, and also you get to keep across all specialties, which I think will tie into number 3, is like you're not really pigeonholed doing one thing over and over again. So if you go down the cardiology, you're not just a stent person or an EP. You've got a lot of medicine to know your entire.
Professional diversity is the other thing. Number 3?
Pretty good in terms of your work-life balance as well.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it is quite slow stream. There is time to make decisions. Not decisions aren't as emergent. There are geriatric emergencies, but in a frailer population, you've got a bit more time. They're not as call you in the middle of the night to change something too much. There is a bit more time to do that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
I go with number 4. You're always going to be in a job. If
that's
some people are motivated by that, there are going
to
be more geriatricians and more geriatric patients.
And the population's aging, so you're absolutely right. Look, you're going to be practicing some form of geriatrics. When I was training at St. George Hospital, you know, it was a whole hospital, and the allied health services are pitched up as an acute geriatric facility from bottom up, like emergency, intensive care. It's all geriatric practice. Okay, and number 5.
You work with a lot of very good people. You keep up working relationships with all medical specialists, but you also are involved very closely with nursing staff, physios, social workers, occupational therapy. So you got a real whole health community is involved in geriatric care. So you get to be a big part in a big team that's working to help some of our most vulnerable patients.
Look, you've even convinced me now. All right, thank you, Michael. I wish well in all your future endeavors, my friend.
Thank you. Take care. Cheers. Bye.